Hey guys, welcome to another week of HTBB Youth Online. If we haven't met yet, my name is Aaron.
And I'm Emily. And I'm so glad to be back with you guys. So, Aaron, what's keeping you busy?
Nothing much. Just watching Netflix, sleeping, monitoring the daily cases on news, and having cream crackers as my favorite snack every single evening. What about you?
Well, I just started baking, and yesterday I made chocolate chip muffins. Ooh. And I would show you some pictures, but I definitely ate them all before I could take any. And now, before we start our service today, Aaron here insists that we do a bad joke. So over to you.
Well, the bad joke for this week. Okay, what do you call a can opener that isn't working?
I don't know, Aaron. What do you call a can opener that isn't working?
A can opener.
No. Oh well. Good thing we have worship to lift up our spirits again. I'm going to pray and we are going to worship together. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this time that you've given us to spend together as a youth group. And thank you that you're going to teach us about how we can spend more time with you during the week. As we go into worship now, we lift up our hearts to you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Let's worship.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel. stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. And even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop.
Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you are with us no matter what's going on around us. And today our hearts are open to receive all that you have for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, thank you so much, guys, for leading in worship together. Today we are starting a new series titled Spiritual Habits, and we'll explore the why and the house on spending time with God.
But before we start, let's begin with an icebreaker game.
Well, we hope that you enjoyed the icebreaker game earlier. And hey, I'm so excited that right now we are starting a brand new series called Spiritual Habits. And in this part one of our series, I'm going to share a little bit on why spiritual habits are good for you. Brand new girl. Well, that song is about this girl talking about her ex and saying, you know, good for you, you look happy and healthy. Good for you, you're doing great out there without me. God, I wish that I could do that. Well, good news is, you can do that. You can be happy and healthy in the inside. You can do great things, but here's the catch. You can do it with God. Joy, life, and life to the full seems to be something we all chase after. And whether you realize it or not, that on a daily basis, we try to chase this sense of satisfaction by either we binge on Netflix, we have countless scrolling on social media, we play video games, countless scrolling on social media, we try to keep ourselves busy and productive, countless scrolling on social media. If I say countless scrolling on social media already, countless scrolling on social media. And we do all of this in hopes that it will give us life and life to the full. But the truth is, only Jesus can give you life and life to the full. In John 10:10, Jesus said, I have come to give you life and life to the full. But I want to challenge us a little further. Don't come to Jesus just because you want something for yourself, but come to Jesus with an attitude of, just because I love Jesus. And let me tell you that that attitude is good for you. In my talk today, I want to propose to you why you should consider having a relationship with Jesus and how you can pursue a loving relationship with Him. I want to begin by sharing this quote from Freddie Mercury, who is the lead singer of this band called Queens. He once said this in an interview. He said, you can have everything in the world and still be the loneliest man. And that is the most bitter type of loneliness. Success has brought me world idolization and millions of pounds, but it has prevented me from having the one thing we all need, a loving, ongoing relationship. And that's what Jesus offers, a loving, ongoing relationship. And if you are new to church or the Christian faith and have no idea what is this, you know, ongoing relationship with Jesus all about, and you know, this God who claims to be love, well, let's watch a short video before we move on to our first discussion break.
The first verse of the Bible, Genesis 1:1, tells us that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The Bible teaches that God created everything that is, including you and me. The implications of that are huge. If God made us, then He is ultimately in charge. He owns us and we're responsible to Him. He retains full rights over us as the designer and creator of human life. The Bible tells us that people were created in God's image to enjoy a perfect relationship with Him and with each other. God intended and designed the ultimate in quality and quantity of life for His people, the people that He had made. Part of this ultimate relationship between God and His people included His desire to have men and women choose to love and serve Him for who He is, willingly and freely. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 16 tells us that God is holy. That means that God is perfect. This verse also tells us that God requires that people be holy too. Unfortunately, from the beginning, the people that God had made chose to use their freedom to please themselves instead of obeying God and being holy. The Bible calls this sin. Because people chose to sin, they forfeited their privileged position and their ultimate relationship with God ended. The Bible teaches that everybody born since Adam and Eve were born into a state of separation from God. Sin created a barrier that ruined what should have been a perfect relationship with God. The Bible also tells us that God is just. Because He's perfectly just, He cannot overlook sin. His justice requires a payment for sin. According to passages like 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9, God promises to punish sin severely and exactly. Though God's grace and kindness prevails during the present age, the Bible is clear that there will come a time when each person will stand before God and a payment for sin will be required. That's what hell is all about. It is a place away from God's kindness where people will pay for their sins that they've committed. Thankfully, 1 John 4:8 tells us that God is a loving God. His love for sinful and separated people has provided a solution, a way out for people who would otherwise have no hope. This is the good news. Much like an umbrella, God has provided Jesus, His own Son, God in human form, who has endured the punishment that we deserve so that we will not have to. As God, Jesus lived a perfect life for us, as well as incurring the wrath of God for us while dying on a cross. Because the umbrella is rained on, there's a place beneath it that isn't. So it is with Christ. After living the life we needed and dying the death we deserved, Jesus rose from the dead to prove to the world that sin and the penalty for sin had been adequately dealt with. What Jesus has done for us is definitely good news, but it does not do us any good until we respond to it the way that God requires. Though many believe that amassing a lifetime of good deeds will somehow earn God's favor and forgiveness, to the contrary, the Bible says that we can acquire God's favor and forgiveness right this moment by repenting of our sins and placing our trust in Christ. If today you choose to turn from your sin and trust completely in what Jesus has done for you, then God's Spirit will place you in Christ, and you're guaranteed to never incur the punishment your sins deserve. Are you ready to do that right now? If so, express to God your desire to be in Christ. Tell Him you will right now turn from your sin and that you are placing your trust in what Jesus has done to save you.
Well, we hope that you had a great discussion time. And hey, if you made that decision to follow Jesus at the end of the video earlier, I just want to say congratulations. Welcome to the family. Now, God loves all of us, and His love to us demands a response. Now, let me illustrate it in this way. I remember right after high school, I got into my first serious relationship with a girl. And I remember on this one particular day, we were heading towards a cafe. It was a casual day, you know, it was a good day. We're just hanging out. And while we were walking there, she said something that caught me off guard. She suddenly blurted out and said, "I love you," for the first time. And I was so shocked. I didn't know how to respond. And all I said to her was, thank you. And that got her really upset. And she was like really upset. I was like, okay, I'm sorry. I was caught off guard. Let me rephrase what I really wanted to say. What I really wanted to say is, me too. And that made her even more upset. Now, what she was hoping for me to say is that she was hoping for me to say, "I love you too." Now, that is no difference in a relationship with God. When God came and died on the cross for us, in John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world, He loves us, and His love demands a response." And that's why one of the greatest commandments in the Bible, it says that love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. It's a wholehearted love. But how do we do that? And I want to bring you to this story in John chapter 12. And we're going to read this story together. This was Jesus being anointed by this particular woman named Mary. So let's read beginning verse 1. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus has raised from the dead, previous chapter. Here, a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas, who later were to betray him, objected, "Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages." He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. As keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself with what was put into it. "Leave her alone," Jesus said. "It was intended that she would save this perfume for the day of my burial. You'll always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me." And now, in the book of Luke, in the same story but written by a different author, in Luke 7:45, it says this, Jesus telling to Judas, "Therefore I tell you, many of her sins have been forgiven as her great love has shown." Now, this act of Mary was an act of love. Jesus even commanded her in the book of Luke, "For her great love has shown." So I just want to draw on three ways we can love Jesus, just learning from this particular story. Number one, make Jesus your agenda. Now, Mary poured this expensive perfume on Jesus' feet with no personal agenda. What's in for Mary? Like, serious question, what did she get from pouring this expensive perfume of hers on Jesus' feet? Nothing. She did that simply because she loved Jesus. Not so that Jesus will have favor on her or would bless her or would answer a prayer request, because none of them happened after that. But she did it just because she loved Jesus. And when I think about this, I always think about my grandmother. My grandmother lost her husband when she was very, very young, and she was forced to raise 4 of her children on her own. And she wasn't wealthy. She had like a very difficult time raising up her kids, and she sadly passed away in her early 60s. But one thing that she never stopped doing, as far as I could remember, is that she never stopped making Jesus her agenda. Every day, I remember that whenever she wakes up, she would start her day by praying and reading the Bible. And then she'll go on and clean the house. Sometimes she'll go out for the to the market. She'll make breakfast. And then once we are all awake, we are having breakfast, she'll go into her room and she'll just start worshipping. And this is not like YouTube worship or like guitar or piano. She'll just clap her hands and sing song out loud to God. And then later on in the evening, she'll do the same thing again. And then at night, before she goes to bed, she'll read the Bible, she'll pray, and end her day. And, you know, I often ask myself, like, what is it that, you know, she's praying so hard for? Like, she never stopped doing that, like, as far as I could remember, until the eulogy at her funeral, where everyone in the church said the same thing. They said that she loved Jesus so much. Now, her devotion wasn't of any agenda. It was just because she loves Jesus. Now, I just want to throw this question to you. What does loving Jesus with no agenda can look like for you? Let's discuss. Well, I hope that you had a great discussion and there are some really great suggestions for all of us to consider. Now, the second observation I would like to make out of this story is give your all to Him. Now, Mary wasted her all to Jesus. It says in verse 3, then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it in Jesus' feet and wiped His feet with her hair. Now, scholars agree that the price of this perfume back in the day of Jesus would have cost about a year's wage. We have read that just now in scripture. And that's why Judas was making a lot of fuss about it. And a recent article produced said that the cost in today's time would be about $54,000. Can you imagine that? $54,000 worth of perfume just being wasted at Jesus' feet. And this was probably her most expensive possession that Mary had. But she took her all and gave everything to Jesus. So part of loving Jesus is not just giving half-heartedly or some of your things to Him, but giving your all to Him. The third observation in how we can love Jesus, just learning from the story of Mary, is to stay close to Jesus. Now, Mary was one of those followers who would often stay close to Jesus. She was the one who ran to Jesus and asked Jesus to raise his brother Lazarus when he died. And she was the one who would always be sitting at Jesus' feet. At one instance, her sister Martha was quite upstairs. Why is, look at Mary, you know, Mary is always at your feet. I'm here busy serving everyone. Can you tell her to come and help me? And Jesus said, hey, Mary has chosen the right thing. And here in this another scenario again, we see Mary at doing the same thing, just at the feet of Jesus, just wanting to stay close to Jesus. And she was also one of the few who was with Jesus at the cross when all of his disciples, all of his best buddies ran away, but Mary was close to Jesus. Even so, when Jesus resurrected, the first person Jesus met was Mary, because she stayed close to him at his tomb. And it was as if, like, if Jesus was away, she would experience this some form of, like, you know, separation anxiety. And I think about just that intimacy with Jesus that Mary had, that longing of just wanting to be close to Jesus. I think of my nephew. My nephew just turned 1 year old last week. He's like, you know, the first grandchild of the family. We absolutely love him. And one of the things my nephew Andrew loved is he loves his mom so much. Like whenever he's separated from his mom, like he would cry and like he would make noise. He just can't handle it. And we're just going to take a short pause now and just watch this short clip of him being separated from his mom.
Yay!
Oh my God,
this okay? Yeah, bye.
Well, now, just like, you know, Andrew just wanting to stay close to his mom and just in that pursuit, how can we pursue Jesus in that same manner this week? Let's pause for discussion and discuss this. How can you pursue Jesus this week? Well, I hope you had a great discussion. And hey, next week, Phil is going to be sharing with us on how we can intentionally make time to pursue Jesus. And also, you know, we have a campaign called T10 that invites all of us to do exactly that, on how we can pursue Jesus actively daily. More info to come soon. And that's it for me. I'm just going to say a short prayer now before I pass the time over to Emily. Lord, we just pray that in all that we discuss and as we learn from the story of Mary and how she pursued you and she made you her agenda, we pray, Father, Lord, that you will teach us to make you our agenda and to pursue you in our daily routines. And Lord, help us to love you more and more. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Aaron, for the message this morning. And as you would have briefly heard, our T10 campaign begins in August. We will meet every weekday to do devotions together for about 15 minutes. The highest participating small group wins an exclusive invitation to a pizza party with Brandon Ho. And if there's a daily average of 27 youth participating every day, every one of us wins an exclusive HTBB youth hoodie. You don't want to miss out on that. Hope you guys have a great week ahead and see you soon. Bye!